this thing, I'll quick and put a little plug in for Godspell at Delco Arts. You still have 10 more days to see it. Wednesday through Friday at 7:30 and Sundays at 2. I heard the cast is phenomenal.
Yes, indeed, after Dojinki and Homecoming and now Godspell, we have Holy Trinity people all over the community in roles, so wonderful job leading our community in positive ways. And don't miss Godspell if you can. But good morning and welcome to worship at Holy Trinity on this beautiful fall morning. It's good to be together today. Special welcome to any of you who might be guests with us today. And those joining us on KCHEC radio or local television, we're glad you're in worship with us also today. Today we wrap up our fan or follower worship series. It's our last day of that today, and today we're hearing a message about how Jesus leads us into a meaningful life by the way of the cross. So you'll hear some interesting words that Jesus has to say today. But today we also have a special milestone we're celebrating, and that is our three-year-olds are receiving their first Bible from the church, from parents or caring adults here. So if there are any godparents here, welcome. We're glad you're here also today, and we'll do that also on Wednesday evening. And those of you that have three-year-olds, we do have dinner and a short class where we're just going to open up those Bibles in interactive ways today at 3:30. You're welcome to come back with any adult with you. And then lastly, I just want to mention, we have confirmation actually next week. So mark your calendars. It's a pretty special day, and we have a great split between Sunday and Wednesday, so it should be a great celebratory occasion. We did move it up a few weeks just to make sure, or at least hopefully make sure, Pastor Ben and I would both be here. So next week is confirmation. You don't want to miss it. Lastly, I want to invite Ms. Chris Palma up, and she's going to share a word with us about Trunk or Treat.
Good morning. It's almost that time of year again for our yearly Trunk or Treat event, community Trunk or Treat event. This year it will be held Saturday, October 27th from 5 to 6. If you're interested in decorating your trunk and passing out candy, the Sign Up Genius is set up at the Welcome Center. You can sign up your trunk. We're also looking for two first aid attendants to be available that evening, and a couple parking lot supervisors, just to make sure that the parking lot remains safe throughout the evening, and also a few kitchen helpers for cleanup afterwards. If you're not able to attend or decorate a trunk, we're still looking for candy donations as well. Those can be left in the office before the 27th. And if you have any questions, you can let Jamie or myself know, and we look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Chris. It's going to be a great event. I'll invite you now to stand as we begin in worship together. I invite you to join me with our litany. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship. Costly grace is the call of disciples to leave their nets to follow him. Cheap grace is the kind of grace we give ourselves. Costly grace is the grace that comes from Jesus Christ. Cheap grace relegates discipleship to a select few. Costly grace is the divine command to all Christians without distinction. Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without repentance. Costly grace costs one their life, but costly grace gives one the only true life. Let's pray together. Gracious God, grant us joy as we strive earnestly to follow the way of discipleship. For happy are they who, by following Jesus Christ, are so assured of their heavenly citizenship that they are truly free to live their lives in this world. Happy are they who know that discipleship simply means the life which springs from grace. Amen. You can be seated for our special music. Thank you. I'll invite any young people to come on to the front with me this morning. Come on up. I'm glad to see all of you here this morning. I want to know, is there anything that you really want? Like, let's say it was a birthday or Christmas or something really special. Is there something you really want? Yeah. Xbox? How about you? American Girl dolls. Yeah. A dog? How about you?
Fun video
games. What else?
A TV.
Anybody else? I know we all have things. Yeah, how about one more?
A computer and a TV.
Okay, I want you to picture all those things. And if we asked everybody in here today, I'm sure we'd all have an answer for something we really want. So I want you to picture all those things we just mentioned. Picture a TV, a computer, American Girl doll, video games. Did I miss anything? Xbox. Dog. Okay, maybe even a really big dog. Okay, so I want you to imagine getting all those things. Yeah? You want to imagine that? I know, that's all of us in our hearts. So, okay, if someone were to give you all those things, what would you have to do? If you were going to carry them, can you all do this? Pretend you're carrying all those things, like a big dog, a TV, an Xbox, an American Girl doll. They'd be pretty heavy, right? But we'd all go like this. Hold them really tight so you can get them home. Okay. Well, today, if we were all honest, there are things we all want. Yeah. But today, Jesus is going to tell us something kind of crazy from the Bible. He's going to tell us that while it's okay to want things sometimes like that, really, truly, to make us happy, those things might make us happy for a little while, but to really be happy, Jesus says he actually wants us to live like this. Can you put your arms out? Don't hit anybody next to you. Put your arms out. He wants us to live with our arms out, and instead of wanting to get things to try and make us happy, he wants us to actually put our arms out and help other people. And he says, actually, that's how we're going to really feel happy in life. It's kind of crazy, isn't it? And he calls that the way of the cross because his arms are out helping people. Absolutely, like filling everybody's bucket. You got it. Okay, if you're going to Sunday school this morning, you get to even make your own cross to remind you of that happiness and where it truly comes from today. So will you bow your heads with me and say a prayer? Dear God, while we all want things in life, help us to know that a truly happy life comes from helping others. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people together said, Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. Thanks for coming up today.
A reading from Isaiah, the 50th chapter. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary from a word. Morning by morning he awakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me who will declare me guilty. All of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. Here ends the reading.
Please stand as you're able. Our gospel this morning comes from Mark, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about it. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." Here ends our reading this morning. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. And if you want to follow along today, you can take out one of the black Bibles in the chairs around you and turn to page 820. We're going to be looking at Mark, the 8th chapter, 820. Well, as we enter into this season of elections, today I want you to actually picture with me a political rally. Picture with me the candidate signs, the flags, the hats, the high fives, and the handshakes going around, and the security officers keeping an eye on suspicious behavior. And then I want you to picture with me a candidate stepping up to the microphone to a rousing applause. Picture with me the look in their eye, the confident smile surely on their face, perhaps family and political alliances standing behind them. And then I want you to picture with me their pause. Before they begin their rehearsed speech, naming the key points of their platform and the significant downfalls of their predecessor, and then their vision for a better future. Picture with me also the reactions from the crowd as they describe how they are going to conquer the evils of this world. How, if they are elected, the troubles we all know will subside, and how they have exactly what it takes to make this state, country, world a better place. So that's what I want you to picture today. It's not far from our minds, probably, but today we read our gospel lesson, and I can't help but picture this scene, actually. Because, you see, Jesus and his disciples had been near and around Galilee for quite some time, healing and teaching and working miracles, and no job has been too big for Jesus to handle. Whether it was stilling a storm or feeding 5,000 or healing someone sick or even exorcisms, Jesus was doing it all, and he was getting lots of attention. So as you can imagine, he was the subject of the front page of the paper. He was featured stories on television newscasts, and his Facebook likes and Twitter followers were going out of the roof. And with this crowd of followers getting on the Jesus bandwagon, Jesus steps up to the microphone to give a speech. As the crowds applaud, he steps up to the microphone, and he starts with this really interesting introduction. Rather than this war cry type of declaration, he begins with a question. Jesus says, "Who do people say that I am?" Again, the disciples had literally just witnessed. He had fed 4,000 and healed a blind man just before this. So the people around, when he asked this question, "Who do people say that I am?" they jump to two famous spiritual people they can think of. They say, "Well, Elijah and John." Elijah was this miracle-working prophet in the Old Testament, and John is this larger-than-life figure in the New Testament, preparing the way for Jesus to come. And these two famous, faith-filled people are the best names they can come up with. It's basically like comparing a presidential candidate with the number one ranked president in the United States history. They're trying to say, like, "You're the best, Jesus. That's who people say that you are." And I can imagine Jesus was quiet as he listened. The excited shouts and fist pumps and the poster boards held high, Jesus then steps up to the microphone again and asks another question. This time it's a little more personal, though. He asks to the people, "Who do you say that I am?" And so Peter, who's closest to that vice president role, steps up, quick to respond, and with confidence, Peter doesn't just say, "Well, you're a miracle worker." He doesn't say, "You are a prophet." This time he goes one step further, or maybe three steps further, and says, "I say you're the Messiah. You're the anointed one by God. God has crowned you king," essentially. The Old Testament talks about this Messiah who's going to come and create this new kingdom as a king. And it's like Peter's casting this vision for Jesus, saying, "You're going to create this new world we all want." So first Jesus says, "Who do people say that I am?" Next he says, "Who do you say that I am?" And then Jesus steps back up and essentially gets to this high point of the speech where Jesus answers his own question. He basically says, "This is who I say that I am." So if you were Jesus, I want you to think about, what would you say? I think he'd probably respond like some of the televangelists we listen to or hear. "If you believe in me, your problems will be washed away. If you believe in me and have just a little faith, all your prayers will be answered. Again, if you just follow me, you'll gain everything you want, all the prosperity in the world and more." But that's not Jesus' speech. Jesus took this rally down a totally different road. Rather than casting this vision, when he steps up to answer his own question, rather than casting a vision of a stress-free, worry-free, problem-free future, Jesus actually does the complete opposite. He says, actually, he's going to undergo great suffering. He's going to be rejected. Not only rejected by some people, but by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and he's going to be killed. But he's also going to rise after 3 days. So when Jesus casts this totally opposite vision, then Peter, this VP figure, steps up, interrupts Jesus, and basically says, "Step aside for a second. What are you doing? This is not a good campaign strategy. What are you thinking, Jesus?" But after Peter rebukes him, Jesus speaks to the crowd, and he basically says this. He says, "You've heard what it means for me. It means being rejected, going to the cross, and then being raised. Now I'm going to tell you what this means for you. What this means for you." And he says, "If any of you want to be a follower of me, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me." That's quite a picture. Today we are finishing our sermon series, Fan or Follower. And today we see Jesus tell the disciples and the crowd, tell us what being a follower really means. And again, Jesus says, if you want to be a follower, you have to take up your cross and follow me. And I think it's a really important message to hear. As Christians, I think it's important for us to know being a Christian isn't always easy. It won't naturally fit into our life. It's not popular, and sometimes it'll even take us to places we wouldn't pick. So I want to give you one more image today as we think about what this means really for our life and a life of meaning and purpose. And the image I want you to picture is this: the story of Jonah and the whale. It's this Old Testament prophet, but I want you to picture Jonah because it's all of our life story, I think. Because God wanted Jonah, if you recall, to bring this message to a people that needed to hear a message of forgiveness and hope. God wanted him to go to people he couldn't stand, the Ninevites. He wanted him to go to essentially his enemies. And Jonah said, "Okay, God, except I would much rather go to Tarshish instead. I'd rather go to Tarshish. Nineveh's my enemy, and Tarshish is my friend. And Nineveh's in the middle of nowhere, and Tarshish is this beautiful area on water. It's like vacation land." But God wanted Jonah to take up his cross and follow him to Nineveh. Jonah instead wanted to pack up Jesus and put him in his heart and go to Tarshish instead by the water. And so my question for you today, and for myself too, is how much would we rather just take Jesus and put him in our hearts and go to our places of Tarshish rather than the places Jesus calls us to Nineveh? And you may recall, as Jonah tried to go to Tarshish, God had different plans. Through a storm and the help of a whale, Jonah found himself redirected to go to Nineveh, where God spoke a powerful word of grace to Jonah and to Nineveh. And ultimately, while Tarshish would have led him to initially maybe happiness, it would have led him to an empty life. But God brought him to Nineveh, a place of much deeper meaning where he could go and help others. and ultimately also help himself. So today I want to ask you the question with that image, where is your Nineveh? Where does Jesus say, take up your cross and follow me there? Because a lot of times it's easier to do what we want to do than what God wants us to do. I'll admit it'd be much easier on the pocketbook to keep all our money for ourselves. It'd be much easier on our calendars if we didn't need to spend time in prayer or digging out our Bibles or going to church to be in community. We'd have a lot more time and money and things if we didn't need to care for the poor and the hungry and the homeless and those who are hurting. And frankly, we'd be a lot more popular if we didn't need to associate with people who were outcasts or people struggling with addiction or mental illness or sickness or the other political party, whatever that is. We could feel, at least initially, a lot more secure if we could just do what we wanted rather than listen for what God wants us to do. And frankly, we could probably appear more perfect if we never had to ask anyone for forgiveness. And our pride could stay intact if we never had to offer it. But the life of faith calls us to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow. Follow Jesus into places of deeper meaning and ultimately life. Well, at the end of his speech, Jesus showed the disciples and the crowds that taking up our crosses, going to our Ninevehs, isn't for the purpose of self-inflicted harm either. Jesus is not saying, and hear this loud and clear today, Jesus is not saying we should seek suffering for suffering's sake, nor is he saying or justifying oppression in any way. But Jesus is trying to draw us to a life of deeper meaning and happiness. So Jesus finishes saying with these famous words from Mark 8. He says, for those who want to save their life, actually lose it. If you try and save your life, it'll be empty, essentially. And those who lose their life or open their life will save it and have a deeper meaning. He says, for what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? So people of Holy Trinity, we are called to follow this man named Jesus. He's more than a miracle worker. He's more than a prophet. He's the Messiah. He's a new king. And Jesus shows us that being a Christian doesn't mean avoiding pain and suffering. It actually means entering into it. Now, if we were a fan, all we'd need to do is attend a Jesus campaign rally. We could just put our stake in our yards and bumper stickers on our cars, and it'd be pretty simple. But Jesus is asking us to be followers, and that means changing the way we live. And I think Jesus is telling the truth that actually the way of the cross calls us to forgive and apologize, to care for the neighbor and love the enemy, and extend God's grace even to the Ninevites. And this vision of Jesus surprises even the most faithful people, because it's ironic that if we actually lose our lives or open our lives for his sake, in the end, we'll end up saving it. Amen. I'll invite you to stand and we'll sing together. You can be seated and we'll gather our first and best in offering to God and have our noisy offering in the front for young people. Please stand as you're able. I'll invite you to be seated now, and any three-year-olds, I'm going to invite you to come forward. Any three-year-olds with a parent or parents, caring adults, godparents, whoever you want to bring up with you. Come on up. Whoever would like to, you can come on up to the front. Wiggles are welcome too. Well, we have a special privilege this morning of celebrating a milestone. And here at Holy Trinity, we have milestones that are based on the promises we make at baptism. So at anyone's baptism, young or old, we make promises as a church, as parents, as godparents, to support young people or older people in their faith. And we align those milestones with the promises we make. And one of those promises is to place in children or older people's hands the Bible. And so today, each of our three-year-olds is going to receive a Spark Storybook Bible. And I want to say, if there are any four-year-olds through third graders who haven't gotten one, you can also just let Pastor Ben or myself know after the service, and we'll get you one too. But today, we want to encourage any caring adult who's here with a three-year-old to come on over and pick up one of these Spark Storybook Bibles and simply give it to your child that's with you today. So if you want to come on over, if you want to bring your child, you can pick a storybook Bible, and then we'll come back out together. Come on and pick one out. And this is the Bible we use in Sunday school and crew time up until third grade, and then you'll get a different one that's a little more age appropriate at that point. And three-year-olds, we want you to take these home, wear them out, ask your parents to read them, or maybe you can read them to a parent or grandparent or babysitter, whoever you have in your life. And we want you to just use them, okay? And these are the Bibles you'll recognize when you go to Sunday school or crew time. So if you would, we're just going to have a little prayer. So if you bow your heads, we'll say a prayer all together. God, as these three-year-olds receive a new Bible today, we pray that you will open their hearts and their ears to come to know you and the incredible love you have for them. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats and enjoy your new Bible. I'll invite all of us to stand now, and we're going to confess our faith in the God we know together. Join me, please. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You can remain standing. And we're going to sing the prayers of the people today. So we'll begin singing once through, and then we'll have a prayer, sing again, one more prayer, and we'll close with this song. So join. God, you taught and healed. You listened and changed lives. We pray today for those who need your life-changing healing presence in body, mind, or spirit. Especially today, we pray for Marcia Jarrett and others we now name silently in our hearts that are hurting. Now we sing together. God, you have invited and encouraged all of us to follow you. Help us to hear today that following you may sometimes take us to places initially we may not want to go, but ultimately are for our good and your glory. Help us to listen and to know who you are and what it truly means to be a follower of you. And now we sing together. Thank you. And now we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, as you go on your way today, be comforted in knowing that Christ goes with you. He goes before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you watching over you, and within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Watch.
Now go in peace, serve the Lord.